Hey guys, this is MacHeads101, and today I'm going to be talking about this puzzle. So, I know very little about this puzzle because my friend John, who's also in MacHeads101, found this lying around his house, and his parents didn't know where they got it or what it was called, and it doesn't have any brand names or logos on it. But John tried to solve this for a couple hours and couldn't figure it out, so he lent it to me to try to solve. And because we didn't have a name for it, we decided to nickname it the SixStair, mainly because there's six tubes and they go up in what looks like a staircase, so it's the SixStair. So here's what it looks like solved. Essentially, you have all the red balls in the biggest tube, all the green balls in the second largest tube, the yellow balls in the third largest tube, etc. And you turn it just by rotating the top tubes like this and flipping it, and then you would rotate the top tubes again and flip it again to scramble it a little bit, but I'm not going to do that just because I don't want to scramble the physical version because it's old and rickety and it's not fun to turn. But in order to show you what this puzzle turns like better so that you can actually see it well and I don't have to make the annoying sound of flipping it, I'm going to go ahead and show you a 3D emulation that I made of this puzzle, which is a little buggy right now. I might work on a little better one, or maybe one of you guys wants to, but it will get the job done, at least for this video, to show us how the SixStair turns and works. So here it is. This is actually a web app, which you should be able to run in your browser if you have WebGL enabled. If you don't know what that is or how to enable it, you can look it up. I'll have a link maybe. But here it is. You can just scroll around by clicking and dragging. You can turn the top clockwise and counterclockwise with the right and left arrow keys, and you can flip it upside down using the space bar. And as an example of just a basic scramble, I'm going to do a clockwise turn, then I'll flip it upside down, then I'll do five more clockwise turns like this. And as you can see, this has left all of the tubes basically with their color intact, except now there's a red ball on top of each color. And if I flip it again, you can now see there's a red ball on the bottom and they make this cool staircase-like pattern. It's actually kind of fun to watch them fall like that. But anyway, here's an example of a cool pattern. Now I'll just show you what it looks like when it's kind of messed up and scrambled. So I'm just going to do some random moves to get it into a weird state. And I'm not doing them too fast because this emulator that I wrote is a little bit buggy, so if I do moves too fast sometimes, weird things happen, which I will certainly be working on, but not too vigorously since this is just a little hobby project. But anyway, here we go. This looks pretty messed up, and I'll just get all the balls in the bottom and then I'll show you. So here we go. Here's an example of what this puzzle might look like scrambled. Here in this case, I have this blue tube solved here. I'm gonna make sure the blue tube isn't solved actually. There we go. Now no tubes are solved, so this is pretty scrambled, and it's actually very difficult to get it from this state to being solved, just with intuition or with just doing random moves, and there are clearly very many permutations of this puzzle, so it would be pretty hard to just brute force it with a program. So I decided I wouldn't try to solve this myself, but I would write a program, but because I didn't know, it's pretty clear that I can't just brute force this by trying every permutation because there's so many permutations of the puzzle that it would take too long for a computer to do that. But I wanted to figure out maybe how to break up the problem so that I could get my computer to solve it. So first things first, I'll talk a little bit about how I represent this puzzle in my program, how I tell my program the scramble that I'm looking at so that it can go ahead and try to solve parts of it or all of it, and how my program tells me what moves to do. So I'll do these in the reverse order of what I just said. So first I'll talk about the notation that I used for this puzzle a little bit. So the notation is just a way that the program or me or whatever can write down what moves to do on the puzzle. And in this case it's pretty simple because the only moves you can really do are a clockwise turn, a counterclockwise turn, and a flip. So I decided T would stand for turn and F would stand for flip. And I would have a number that comes after every T that would be the number of times I turned it. So T1 would be one clockwise twist and T-1 would be one counterclockwise twist. And likewise, T2 would be two clockwise twists, and T-2 would be two counterclockwise twists. And it actually does matter in most cases which direction you do the twist, because balls might fall down in a different tube depending on which way you twist the top. So anyway, that's the notation. Anyway, that's how it represents a sequence of moves. It's just like a piece of text. Then I have the way the program actually represents the puzzle. So internally, the program knows about the how the puzzle turns just by having a list for 12 different tubes. The bottom tubes are 6 and the top tubes are 6. So there's 6 top tubes and 6 bottom tubes. And each list is just a list of numbers where each number represents a color of a ball. And whenever you flip the puzzle, it just flips the lists and drops all the elements of the lists down to the bottom to emulate gravity. So that's how my solver represents the puzzle internally. And then the last step, or the first step, the way I tell my program what to do, is how I type in a scramble. And for this, I essentially, and I'll show you here, I read it the bottom color in this tube, then the two colors in this tube, then the three colors in this tube, then the four colors here. And so I ended up typing just 21 colors, and each color is just a letter, the first letter of that color's name, except for black, which I made D for dark, because B was already taken for blue. But anyway, so that's how it works, how you enter a puzzle, how it represents it, and how it tells you the solution. So now I'll show you the first program I wrote in order to attempt to solve this puzzle. So I knew pretty quickly that I wouldn't be able to brute force the entire puzzle, but I hoped and was actually correct in guessing that I would be able to brute force a single tube. So my program can guess basically just every set of moves that's like 10 moves long or whatever, just to solve one of these tubes, so maybe to get all the yellows or all the blues or whatever. So here I have this scrambled puzzle, and I think I'm gonna have my program solve the tube with 4 balls in it. So this program I called tube solve just because it solves a tube, and the only one flag makes it only solve only show you one solution, and I will solve the tube with 4 pieces in it. So now I'm gonna enter in the tube, and you'll see how I enter it in, and I'll probably speed this up. But I'm just going to spin the puzzle around like this and enter in each tube from the bottom up. So black is the only exception. It's D for dark. Then blue, there's 2 blues in that one. Then here there's red, green, red. Red, green, red. And here there's red, green, yellow, green. Whoops. And here, and I'll probably speed it up now. And hopefully I just typed that in correctly. And typing in this puzzle isn't actually that much of a chore. It's a lot harder to type in a Rubik's Cube, but it's still kind of painful. So I'm running it now, and it's going to run through, and meanwhile we can check that it actually got the representation correct, because it prints out like an ASCII art version here. But here's the solution to the tube with 4 balls in it. It's actually 11 moves, which is unusually high for that tube because it's only 4 balls, but I'll go ahead and do it now. So it's 4 top turns, which is the equivalent in this case of 2 counterclockwise turns. So I'm just going to do that because it's fewer. But most of the time they won't be equivalent, so you have to watch out for that. So here you can see that the 4 yellow balls are indeed solved. The rest of the puzzle, you can see, is actually mainly the pieces are above where they should be. That's because all the solver cares about is this tube. It doesn't care literally about anything else. So if I want to get the rest of those balls in the, you know, the base tubes, I can just do a couple top turns to flush them down there. And here's the normal shape that we're used to. And you can see that this tube with 4 balls is indeed solved. So this was the first step, and it was very reassuring. I was actually able to brute force the biggest tube as well, which was usually like an 11 or 12 move solution. And I thought that was pretty cool, and it was encouraging that I was able to do that just with brute force. But it wasn't good enough to solve the entire puzzle. And because of that, What I was able to do with it was to solve the smallest tube and then solve the two smallest tubes and the three smallest tubes and the four smallest tubes. But from there, I couldn't get the fifth smallest tube while keeping the other four. And I definitely couldn't get the sixth one while keeping the other five. So the tube solving technique was good, but it wasn't actually good enough to get the entire puzzle solved. But what I did do was I was able to solve the first four tubes with it, with just this bare bones technique. And from there, I took the next step to solve the next biggest tubes in smaller chunks so that it could be faster. So I had the four smallest tubes solved, and then I wrote another program where I would type in, and I won't show you this because it's kind of a pain in the ass to type in what you want it to do, but you would type in the entire puzzle like a scramble, but then you would also type in what you want it to look like. And with that, you could use wildcards. So I would type in the four bottom tubes as solved, the four smallest tubes. But then for the fifth one, I would only care about this one green ball at the bottom, and I wouldn't care about these four on the top or any of the reds. And it could usually solve the first green ball, and then the second green ball, and then the third green ball, and then the fourth green ball, and the fifth green ball in order. You know, each would take 11 moves to do while preserving the other four tubes, but it could do it. So I could essentially fill it up and then fill this one up as well and get it completely solved. And that was the first way that I managed to solve this entire puzzle. I used this tube solver to basically brute force all four first tubes, you know, all the four smallest tubes. And then I used my wildcard solver to solve all these balls in order from that point. And this solution is very rough because I had to run a program like six times and enter in the puzzle each time. And, you know, it was actually a lot more than six because I had to run it one for each ball. And I would end up doing probably upwards of 100 moves on the puzzle, and I would run the program a ton and just sit there for like 5 or 10 minutes using my program to solve the puzzle. But that was the first way that I actually was able to solve this programmatically. So I had the tube solver, and then I had the piece-by-piece solver. Now, the final solver that I came up with, and I'm just going to scramble this a little more so that I can get a new scramble that's not as neat and doesn't have all the yellows solved. My final solver, which is currently my best solver, although I'm sure it couldn't be that hard to improve on it more, what it does is it never does anything more than like 10 moves. And the first thing it tries to do is solve all the balls. That quickly doesn't work in 10 moves. So it tries to solve all the balls minus 2. And that quickly doesn't work. Then it tries to solve all the balls minus 3. That doesn't work. So it tries to do as many as possible. It'll usually get down to like 6 balls before it can do it in 10 moves. And then from there, it'll try to get the next couple, and then the next couple after that. So it's basically just a step. It's just what I did for the last two tubes, but it starts by being ambitious and trying as many as possible and then lowering its standards as it goes forward. So that's my current solver, and I will give you a demonstration of it because maybe that wasn't very clear in my explanation. But so it just solves the balls in order like that, going up through the bottom. And it's pretty clear to me that it's way more efficient. You really want to have the correct balls of the right color on the bottom, and then as you go up, it's less and less difficult. Because if you have like a black one all the way at the bottom of this tube, it seems like it's a real pain to get that one, that black over here. So the reason my solver works this way is because it's just my observation after playing with the tube solver and the wild card solver enough that you want to solve the bottom of the tube first and then go up. But anyway, enough of my talking, which might all be wrong because I really know very little about this puzzle besides what I've observed through my program. I'm going to go ahead and show you my final solver, and I'll give you an example solve, and I'll probably speed it up because the solutions are still very many moves, usually around 60 or 70, because it solves only a couple balls at once. So here we go. I'm going to type in this scramble. Okay, and so I've now typed in the scramble, and Right now it's just going down from 21, and you can see it got all the way down to 3 before giving up. So it's going to do the first 3 balls in 9 moves. So I'm going to do that now. And you'll see that it keeps working on solving more balls as I'm doing what it's saying. So it just got 6 there with another 9 moves. So I'm going to go ahead and do this. So I'll speed up the video while I do this and while this solves it. And you'll see that I can't even do moves as fast as this thing can come up with more of the solution. So it's actually pretty efficient. So here we go. You can see that it actually did get it solved. And if I add up how many moves this was, let's see, 9 plus 9 plus 8 plus, oh god, I hate these results getting in front of everything, 5, 9, 8, 9. So this was 57 moves, which isn't so bad, and you can see that the last ball was really just one move, which is pretty reasonable. So this is a good example of how my solver works. You can see that it just solves 3 balls, then 6, then 8, then 9, then 10, then 14, then 20. I noticed that 14 is often a milestone that it reaches. I guess sometimes it's really easy to get from 10 to 14. It does that a lot. So this is basically, I know very little about this puzzle still. I just wrote this program and it solves it. But anyway, feel free to play around with this WebGL emulator. The source code for all this stuff is online. And basically, I'm just making this video to show you guys my thought process in writing a program to solve this puzzle, and to get feedback on how you guys would do it, or if you know where to get this puzzle, or if you want to make a better 3D representation of it, or whatever, go ahead and do it. Leave a comment, GitHub issue, whatever. So thanks for watching, subscribe, and goodbye.